Well, welcome to worship for May 31st, 2020, Pentecost Sunday, Willow United Methodist Church. I am Joe D. Dowling Soka, one of the pastors at Willow United Methodist Church. Christina Dowling Soka is the other. Christina is going to be flying the dove at the children's chat for Pentecost Sunday, and she'll be leading us in prayers. Mary Lemmings is with us today playing the piano, and I'm getting to preach about the Spirit and four scriptural presentations of the Holy Spirit to us. We'll be talking about that today. If you can, go to Facebook, the Facebook page, Willow United Methodist Church, Alaska, and download, print the bulletin. That'll be very helpful to you in the worship today. May you be blessed by the Spirit today in worship. See you later. I invite you to join us in the greeting, as is printed in your bulletin. In the darkness and emptiness of much we call life, the Spirit moves among us, calling us into new being.
We are here to seek light amid the shadows, fulfillment out of hollowness and despair.
From separation and bitterness, apathy and hatred, Christ calls us to steadfast love and reconciliation.
We have come to find healing and peace, to experience forgiveness, acceptance, and purpose.
The Holy Spirit beckons us. Come, Holy Spirit, baptize us with your fire. Our hymn is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. It's number 384 in your hymnal. Put it down.
Love divine, all loves excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation into every trembling heart. Breathe, O breathe thy loving Spirit into every troubled breast. Let us all in thee inherit, let us find that second rest. Take away our bent to sinning, Alpha and Omega be, end of faith as its beginning, set our hearts at liberty. Come Almighty to deliver, let us all thy light receive. Suddenly return and
I'd like to invite the children to come up close for our children's message. It's a very special day. It's the day we call Pentecost. Can you say that? Pentecost Sunday.
Pentecost Sunday.
And it's a day where we celebrate how God is always with us and how God sends God's Spirit to be with us. And I have this kite. Can you see my beautiful Holy Spirit kite? And it reminds me that how the Spirit moves in our lives. And I'm going to fly this Spirit kite. And I wonder if you, where you are, can do some moving too. Just remembering how God's love moves in our lives. And how the Spirit can soar in our life too. We often think of Pentecost as the birthday of the church. Can you sing Happy Birthday, Church, with me? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear church. Happy birthday to you. Let's pray. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
That you send.
That you send.
The Spirit.
The Spirit.
To remind us.
To remind us.
That you can move.
That you can move.
In our lives.
In our lives.
Amen.
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 Let's sing Jesus Loves Me.
Jesus loves me.
We come to our time of community prayer. As we begin this prayer, we sing this wonderful song, Come Spirit Come. You'll find the words in your bulletin.
Come Spirit come and fill our soul. We hunger now. Touch us now and hold us near. Come, Spirit, come, be with us here, both in our laughter and our tears. Transform us now.
God of wind, word, and fire, we bless your name this day for sending the light and strength of your Holy Spirit. We give you thanks for all the gifts, great and small, that you have poured out upon your children. Accept us with our gifts to be living praise and witness to your love throughout all the earth. Through Jesus Christ,
who lives with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever.
We invite you to breathe deeply, to reflect, and to rest in God's presence. Come, Spirit, come.
Come, Spirit, come and fill our soul. We hunger now to be made whole. We bring our dreams, our joys and fears. Touch us now and hold us near.
Well, happy Pentecost. Our sermon today is about Pentecost, in a sense, the birthday of the church. Not directly, it's about four scriptures that bring four different perspectives to how the Spirit works in our lives. And I want to share those with you. It's going to be very brief with each scripture. You can get a look at those scriptures. They're printed out, and also some reflective readings that have some thoughts about each one. You can get that by going to Facebook and going to Willow United Methodist Church Alaska Facebook page and downloading and maybe printing that bulletin for today. One page has the scriptures, the other page, it's the last page, has the reflective readings. My hunch is that you're going to learn some things about how different authors understand the scripture, understand how the Spirit works in our lives and in the body of the church. And you're also going to get an idea of which one of these authors is closest to your understanding of the Holy Spirit. But there is a fifth understanding that I wish to start with today, and that comes from Howard Hanger. And in those reflective readings, you can follow along with Howard's writings. It's just fabulous. It's just wonderful the way he talks about it. He says, Holy Spirit, it can change your attitude. It can change your relationships. It can change your job. It can change the world. It is the nature of fire to transform everything it touches. The tiniest flame transforms wood into ash, oxygen into carbon dioxide, dark into light, cold into hot, water into steam, marshmallows and Hershey bars into s'mores. Put a flame even near something and it transforms. A tiny little flame turns a nondescript cake into a birthday cake, an ordinary table into an altar, a meal into a romantic rendezvous, a scary tent in the woods into a cozy place for stories and snuggling. If there is one thing that the Holy Spirit is good at, it's fanning the fire in your soul. We may be the light of the world, but sometimes our soul fire burns down into a flickering ember. It gets buried under so many buckets of ash and garbage that we forget that it's even there. Enter the Holy Spirit, blowing and puffing and galling and gusting, stirring and stoking, prodding and poking, getting our spirit fire burning bright. The Holy Spirit blows through dances, grief and giggles, thunderstorms and thoughtful moments,
silliness, and silence. The Holy Spirit knows no bounds. Isn't that wonderful? What a great image of the Spirit. And all of our authors in Scripture today would agree with Howard. The Holy Spirit knows no bounds. Well, let's get at it. So let's start with Acts chapter 2. I'm going to suggest to you that the spirit of inclusion is what the author of Acts, Luke Acts, has for us today. I'm going to read a part of the scripture. You can read along and then read the entirety of it. But it begins like this. When Pentecost day arrived, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound from heaven, like the howling of a fierce wind, filled the entire house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. There were pious Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. When they heard this sound, a crowd gathered. They were mystified because everyone heard them speaking in their native languages. They were surprised and amazed, saying, "Look, aren't all the people who are speaking Galileans, every one of them? How then can each of us hear them speaking in our native language?" When the flames of the Spirit came upon each one, suddenly they were unified. They became one. Maybe. At least that's what Luke in Acts is sharing with us. That the Spirit was able to touch each one. And through these Galileans, who are the least of the Jewish world of that time, became communicators of God to each one of them. They were all surprised, it says in verse 12, and bewildered. Surprised and bewildered by a God who would bring such diverse peoples together into community. Now, why do I know there's a community? Look in your reflective readings. The very last part of chapter 2, the very last paragraph says, a sense of awe came over everyone. God performed many wonders and signs through the apostles. All the believers were united and shared everything. And then in the very last, the Lord added daily to the community. So chapter 2 begins with the coming of the Spirit, and it ends with the gathering of the community of all of these diverse people included in that community. A spirit of inclusion. In your story, have you seen where the Spirit brings people who are not alike together into community? Has that happened in your life, in yourself, diversity included? I hope so. That's what Luke thinks the Spirit does when the Spirit touches us. It grows community. Then, let's go to 1 Corinthians. We got to go fast. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now, these are words of Paul. And I'm going to suggest to you that Paul's understanding of the Spirit is egalitarianism. That this is a spirit of egalitarianism. No hierarchies. Now, in our world, we learn hierarchy in kindergarten, right? We know how to line up. And we know who's at first, and we know who's at the last. We know in elementary school when they're choosing sides to play basketball. We know hierarchy. We know hierarchy when we look out and see whose house is better than ours, or we think better than ours, or who seems to have more money, or who has more education, or who has less, or we know hierarchy, even within the body of Christ. But Paul doesn't believe that hierarchy is what the Spirit brings. Here's some of this reading. You can read the rest on your own, but the beginning goes, "Brothers and sisters, I don't want you to be ignorant about spiritual gifts." Let's move on down. Let's go to verse 4. "There are different spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are different ministries and the same Lord. And there are different activities, but the same God who produces all of them in everyone. A demonstration of Spirit is given to each person for the common good." And then Paul lists some of the gifts that are given to different folks. And then in verse 11, "All these things are produced by the one and same Spirit who gives what he wants to each person." If you read into the reflective readings, one from Brian Peterson, he talks about how the body was an image that philosophers used during Paul's time, but they used it differently than he does. Paul changed it, but what they did with it was that they believed that the body was a great metaphor and there has to be a head. And the head, of course, was the king, Caesar, or was Alexander before that. I mean, this is a common idea. Or it's the rich. But there was a hierarchy, the oligarchy. Places, of course, and the Greeks had a lot of oligarchy understandings. The rich were the ones who were the head of the whole establishment, and everybody else were the hands and the feet and different parts. Paul changes the image. Verse 12, "Christ is just like the human body. A body is a unit and has many parts, and all of the parts are one body, even though there are many. We are all baptized into one Spirit, into one body, by one Spirit, into one body. Whether Jew or Greek or slave or free, and we all are given one Spirit to drink." Now, how does Paul do this? He turns it on its head by understanding that Jesus is the head. And through the Spirit, all of us, there's no hierarchy. We are all, as diverse as we may be, as different as we may be, as differently talented and gifted as we may be, we are all in this together as equals. I love that line, and Paul does this again in other passages that he writes. "Whether Jew or Greek or slave or free, or male or female, rich or poor, educated or not, landed or not, citizen or not, no matter what color your skin may be, no matter how you dress, all, no hierarchy, all are in and all are gifted because we have one Spirit, one God, and Jesus reveals that." A spirit of egalitarianism. All right, that's two. Let's go to three. Psalm 104. Now here is a spirit of creation, I suggest to you. This is an amazing psalm. Now listen to this. Just start the beginning. "Lord, you have done so many things. You made them also wisely. The earth is full of your creations. And then there's the sea, wide and deep, with its countless creatures, living things, both small and large. There go the ships on it, and Leviathan," huge fish that destroys little ships easily, which you made, plays in it. Now, the nuance of that is kind of missed when it's translated into English. It's not simply that Leviathan plays in creation. It's that God enjoys Leviathan's playing in creation. In fact, the implication is that God that God created creation, that God creates in order to enjoy the playing of and in creation. Leviathan is an example. And the psalmist would suggest to us that if God enjoys that, then God also enjoys our playing in creation. He also talks about breath. Go down to verse 30. When you let loose your breath, they are created. So there's this understanding, not just in this psalm, but throughout the Hebrew world, there of ruah, the breath of God. And that breath is the enlivenment to the dust. You are alive because you possess. God has breathed on you. You possess the breath of God. Maybe that is a little bit of what Genesis is talking about when we're made in the image, that we are made with God's breath. Anyhow, we are, our job to the end of this passage is to sing praises to God. That's what creation does. The spirit of creation. We're made to rejoice. We're made to sing. We're made to play. And God enjoys that with us. There's the spirit of creation is one that maybe many of us really connect with, because we maybe find God and we maybe know the spirit's touch when we're on a mountain somewhere, or when we're on a boat and running a rapid, or maybe we're, I don't know. For me, it's a lot of growing things. That's a lot of where I find that spirit. There's a great story that comes from out of Nebraska, at least when I was in Iowa the first time I heard it. It was told to me as it comes from Nebraska. I was reminded of it this week. And the story goes that a grandfather takes the grandson and they, in the middle of the night, walk out into the middle of the corn, the cornfield. Now, maybe they're in the middle of July, the corn's not fully grown yet, obviously, for the story. They lie down, and the grandfather says, "Now just lie quietly and listen. Can you hear the corn growing?" Yeah. Spirit of creation, the breath of God is in even the corn. I think there's something about the growing this time of year here in Alaska. The rhubarb, which just 2 weeks ago was barely breaking out, is now, I think it's growing 3 or 4 inches a day. I love it. Now, I never put my head down to listen to see if I could hear it growing. But what a great joy it is to have things grow in our midst. The breath of God. We understand the breath of God and the baptism in our life because that's what the Spirit does, right? At least Paul told us that the Spirit of God breathes upon us in baptism. One God, one Spirit. Barbara Brown Taylor tells the story of when she was at a baptism that Bishop Desmond Tutu did. And that baptism was what he did was that she thought was so fascinating was he lifted the lid on the font, the baptism font, and then he breathed on over the waters. The breath of God is life itself. And I would share to you that the spirit of creation is a lot like the spirit of egalitarianism and inclusion, right? Because in God's breath of life, it's over all. It's over all. None are excluded. All right, the last one to share with you in our last few minutes together is the spirit of peace, joy, and forgiveness. And you'll find that in John chapter 20, verses 19 through 23. I'm going to read this entire passage to you. It was still the first day of the week. That evening, while the disciples were behind closed doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. When the disciples saw the Lord, they were filled with joy. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." I can see Bishop Tutu over those waters of the font. Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they are not forgiven." One thing to know about this that maybe you didn't realize before, it's obvious when you read them, but we don't put them side by side that often. But Luke's work in Acts, the Spirit is bestowed upon the church through the disciples in the community there on the festival of Pentecost. Whereas in John, the Spirit is upon them, receive the Holy Spirit on the day of Easter, resurrection, while the disciples are hiding behind closed doors. Now, did you hear in here the spirit of peace? They are afraid. And what does Jesus say? What angels always say, but Jesus says it here. He says, "Peace be with you." And he showed them his hands and his side. And when they saw the Lord, perceived it was the Lord, they said, they were filled with joy, the spirit of joy. When we're in the presence of Jesus, there is joy. There is joy. And then Jesus says again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." Out of the locked room, they will go. And he breathed on them, said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." The Holy Spirit that is within them now and within you as well. Now, the Spirit's always been in the Jewish understanding, but somehow their perceptions are changed. They become new and transformed people. My hunch, still just as afraid as ever, but they're going out anyway. If you forgive anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you don't forgive them, they aren't forgiven. If you want to know some more about forgiveness, go ahead and read the words there from Matt Skinner that are in the reflective readings. So we have four different images in Scripture that we've presented today of the Spirit. Spirit of inclusion in the midst of diversity into community. Spirit of egalitarianism, again, into community. Spirit of creation, which is a much larger community. And the Spirit of peace, joy, and forgiveness, which is also all about community. One of the things about the early church's community is that it always understood in all the Gospels that forgiveness was crucial to how they had to live together. Is this not a time when we need the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, not just in our individual lives, not just in the life of Willow United Methodist Church, but in the life of the state of Alaska and all the states, in the federal government, in the whole understanding, in our police departments, not just in Minnesota, but throughout our country? Is this not a spirit? Diversity, inclusion in the midst of diversity, egalitarianism, creation, peace, joy, and forgiveness that our world is needing? God so loves the world, according to John, that Jesus came. The Jesus whom the Spirit maintains and preserves the body of Christ with. And that's you, and that's me. That's all of us together. Our witness is that we have been breathed upon. The Spirit is in us, with us, and around us, and we go forth proclaiming diversity, inclusion, egalitarianism, creation's joy, peace, joy, and forgiveness. Amen.
I invite you to join us in our hymn of response, Spirit of the Living God, fall afresh on me. With you this Pentecost prayer, which was written by Tom Schumann. Let us pray. How shall we pray this morning? We might be out on our deck, sitting at a breakfast table, walking around the loop of the park, but we feel stuck in that upper room, watching, wondering, hoping that the new life, the new hope, the new unknown promised by Jesus will come if we only wait. So be with us, God of gentle breezes, as we wait, as we wonder, as we watch for evidence that grace will come around the corner to sweep us up in its arms. How shall we pray this morning? We might be anchored to our chairs, watching the news however we get it, and we are filled with outrage as well as despair, with a sense that everything is becoming even more uncertain, even more out of control than before. More deaths by COVID as well as by senseless violence. More anger voiced in the streets as well as in the halls of leadership. more racism. And so we pray with you to be with us. Jesus, of those who cry out and those who listen, as we wait, as we wonder, as we watch, for evidence that justice can be as close as the next breath if we only dare breathe it. How shall we pray this morning? We might be exhausted, too weary to move. We might be wondering how we will get through today, much less care about what happened yesterday or thinking about the possibilities of tomorrow. The days have all melted into one big endless one which never seems to end, no matter how often night falls or the sun rises. So come, Holy Spirit, come, please come. As we wait, as we wonder, as we watch for the evidence that God is in our midst, come and blow the fear from our hearts so we can discover the hope that is there. How shall we pray on this Pentecost morning? Come, God in community, holy and one. Come as we wait, as we wonder, as we watch. Come with the evidence that grace has not disappeared, but is crouched outside our door, just waiting for us to welcome it into our lives. As we wait, as we wonder, as we watch, come. With that justice that is not just a theological idea, a prayer, a quote from a long ago speech, but the lives we live for all people, for each person. As we wait, as we wonder, as we watch, come. With that love that values each person as your beloved child, as broken, as brazing, as loving, as leery, as hopeful, as hurtful, as judgmental, as forgiving as each one of us. So we can discover our oneness, not our disunity, and together work toward your dreams of justice, of grace, of love, of hope for all. Amen. And together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of affirmation is Grace Greater Than Our Sin. If you have a Methodist hymnal, it's number 365. The words are in your bulletin. Let's sing together. You to join us in the benediction. as is printed in your bulletin. The
Lord
bless
you
and
keep
you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen and amen.
I pray that you were blessed by worship this last hour. As I say every worship service, remember that generosity is the way of Jesus. So be generous with yourself, with your family, with your neighbor, as Jesus understands that word, and with your church. Remember to be generous with your church. And be gentle as a part of that generosity to yourself. You may be wondering how long we'll be doing these virtual worship services here at Willow United Methodist Church, Alaska. We're probably going to continue the virtual services for a long, long time. That does not mean that we won't be meeting as a congregation physically sometime soon. There is a group that's put together right now. If you would like to be a part of that group, please let Christina know, who is studying the guidelines that have been put out by the United Methodist Church and is trying to figure out how we can gather together as a church and worship. But as you know, even though the building is closed, the church is still open. We are the church. You are the church. We are the church together. And the Spirit has filled us up. And we witness to the grace of Jesus in everything we do. Go forth. Be blessed. Go in Jesus. See you next week. Amen.